Hello and welcome to Vienna, the capital of Austria. I am here at Aqua Days, a conference organized by DSM-Firmenich. And today, my guest is Lorran Gabardo. Welcome, Lorran.
Thank you very much.
Who's the product manager for mycotoxins at DSM-Firmenich. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Good. So, Lorran, can you tell me a little bit about your role with the company and your background as well?
So currently I'm a global product manager. I work with the mycotoxin risk management, more focused into the poultry side, but I also work with aqua and swine. Normally in my role, what I do, I talk about mycotoxin counteraction. And when we're looking to mycotoxins, we have to understand the prevalence and how to counteract them. So that's what I do in a daily basis.
Okay, and is that something you've specialized in for a while?
Yes, when I'm doing my role, I'm coming and talking about the technical part of mycotoxins, because sometimes when we're talking about the production, we're just looking forward, which is the final results that we're going to have in the performance of the animals. But and this is the consequence that we're going to have on profitability. But if you really want to make it professionally, we have to deep dive and look inside what we have in technology that we're bringing to our feed, because this represents 70% of the costs of the production of fish and shrimp, for example.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, no, very much the majority of the costs. And just for those of our listeners who aren't aware, what exactly are mycotoxins?
Well, mycotoxins are secondary metabolites produced by the fungi. This can be produced in the field when we are producing the grains, but also during storage. And these metabolites, they are toxic for the humans as well for the animals. So what we aim is to make these compounds not toxic anymore.
Okay. And why are they, obviously they're toxic, but why are they such a big problem? Why does DSM-Firmenich have such a large expertise and put so many resources into this field of mycotoxins?
Back in the day, maybe for more than 30 years, we are already investing on that, because we know that 95% of the grains that come into our productions, they are contaminated by mycotoxins. And this robs quite a lot the performance and the health of the animals. So what we aim, looking to mycotoxins, is to prevent these negative effects. So we want to protect the health of the animals.
So that's at the point of harvest, 95% of the grains going into diets have some element, a trace, some element of mycotoxins in them.
Exactly. And okay. We have different mycotoxins. Okay. If we look back in the day, we were talking first about aflatoxins. Mm-hmm. And nowadays, we already know that more than 700 mycotoxins, they exist. But for the animal production, we are more used with six of them, where we have a lot of the research and development on that.
Okay. And are these organisms, are they proliferating? Proliferating once the grains have been harvested, when they're being storage, for example, or when they're in the feed mill?
We have two types. Okay. So, for example, there are mycotoxins that they are produced during the grain production. Mm. They are in the field, in the corn, in the soybean kernels. Mm. And they come to our feed already with the contamination of mycotoxins. Okay. This, basically, the most important fungi is the fusarium that produces, for example, zearalenone, the trichotesins, and ochratoxin, and fumonisins. And the second one is the part that are produced during the storage. So, for example, Aspergillus is a very well-known fungi that produces the aflatoxin. And this happens during the storage that we have conditions of moisture and high temperatures.
Okay.
So these are the two ways that we can have the production of mycotoxins by the fungi.
Okay. And what sort of health problems do they cause in aquatic animals, for example?
Basically, all of the mycotoxins, they have an immune effect. So the cytotoxicity of the mycotoxins, they challenge the immune system of the animals, and this takes the performance of these animals. But Some mycotoxins, they have more characteristic effects. For example, the aflatoxins and fumonisins, they have as a target organ, the hepatopancreas. So we are interfering all in the whole metabolism of the animal. Zearalenone is a mycotoxin that has the estrogenic effect. So we're going to see problems in fertility. And when it comes to donor and fumonisins, are mycotoxins that they are very connected with the intestinal integrity. So what we see a lot, 70% of our immunity is in the intestine, as well is where the animals, they absorb the nutrients.
Okay. So they're affecting fish, they're affecting shrimp, they're affecting all sorts of aquatic species.
All the species.
Okay. And can you put a value on the impact, the negative impact that these mycotoxins have on aquaculture?
This is the $1 million question.
Okay.
So, and brief estimation that we can have in the aquaculture industry mm-hmm. is $5 billion US dollars per year.
Wow.
And how do we calculate this? Mm. Based more or less in the feed conversion ratio. So the effects that we're going to have of the mycotoxins into the feed conversion ratio, making this feed conversion ratio higher and in the mortality. So they also make the mycotoxin effect also can cause a higher mortality into the animals.
Okay. So it's a huge threat, something that farmers need to be concerned about. And how can the threat be reduced?
Well, when we're talking about mycotoxin counteraction, we are bringing technology. So there are many different strategies that we can use for mycotoxin counteraction. When we talk about mycotoxin binders, we are focusing in the adsorption strategy. Okay. So this is more focused in aflatoxins and their alkaloids.
Okay.
The biotransformation. Biotransformation is breaking the toxic part of the molecule into non-toxic compounds. They are used for fumonisins, zearalenone, and trichotesins.
Mm-hmm.
And bioprotection. Bioprotection is a support that we're going to give for the hepatopancreas cells as well for the intestine that are the target organs of the mycotoxins.
Okay. So that's the three strategies that you can use. And are there particular products available for that perform these strategies? Do they, or are there some that can perform all three? Or what's the best way of ensuring these strategies work?
Well, we always say that what is important, that also I mentioned today in my talk, is regarding a mycotoxin risk management. Mm-hmm. What is a mycotoxin risk management? It's not just using one product, but understanding which is the contamination that you have by mycotoxins in the feed or in your region. This is the first point. Second one is making this interpretation, which are the effects that you can have into animal health and performance with that levels. And then we're gonna, in the third point, the protection, make the counteraction into the target mycotoxins that we see in the feed of these animals.
Okay, and how widely are these products used?
Worldwide.
Okay.
So we see that this is a threat for all the animal species. Whenever we are talking about bringing better levels to our productions and reducing factors of diseases, mycotoxins, they are always correlated because they are considered predisposing factors for diseases. They are robbing the performance of the animals as well in our industry. It's robbing the profitability of our business.
Okay. And have you guys done any trials to validate how well these products work?
Exactly. The best way to validate or to choose a product for mycotoxins is to have the in vitro tests. So in the in vitro tests, what you're going to have? You're going to see the quality of the product on the adsorption or the biotransformation there in the lab. But also, how can we select a product for the species that we talk about? So we're going to have the in vivo tests. So the validations of the product, they should follow the in vitro and the in vivo tests.
Okay. And what sort of results do you get if you're, you know, what are you hoping to, how much can you improve performance through the addition of these products?
It will depend on the contamination. Mm-hmm. But for example, what was mentioned today on the talk, for shrimp, we can have a rough estimation of 9% on feed conversion ratio. And in fish, in tilapia, for example, we are talking about roughly 6% also in feed conversion ratio.
Fantastic. Does that translate? Yeah, what's the economics behind using or not using these products?
That's a great point. Whenever we are talking about animal production, that it comes to the cost. And this has to be economically viable. Yeah. So what does it come together? A return over investment. Mm-hmm. So we have to have products that they are very well focused in our target strategies. As well, they have to be economic that we can use it widely.
Yeah.
So when we are talking about shrimp, we are talking about a return over investment of almost 15 to 1.
Okay.
This means 0.03 grams per animal that we have to improve to pay what we are investing on a mycotoxin risk management. When it comes to fish, mm-hmm. we are going to have an investment of 6.3, and the return over in and the break even calculation is 1.5 grams per fish per animal.
Okay, so that will improve production, improve the end product weight by that much if you apply these substances.
Exactly.
Okay, fantastic. And how many products do you have in your own line at the moment in terms of ways of managing mycotoxins?
We have 6 products in line.
Okay.
So these 6 products is that we have difference in formulation of the products. Mm-hmm. Because we have to check which the species that we are talking about, which are the contamination levels. Then we go for which is the strategy behind of using each of these products as well with their dosages. So that's why it's so important to have a mycotoxin risk management where we are seeing which is the contamination level and you're correlated that with the choice for a product.
Okay. And are you working on developing some new ones?
Yes. We are looking here in the DSM-Firmenich, we are looking forward on the development of the enzymes. Mm. So we are very focused on bringing this technology and innovation into the enzymes. Why? Because the enzymes, they are very effective. They have a very high speed of reaction. Mm-hmm. And we have an irreversible way of counteraction. So we are guaranteeing that these compounds, they are not going to be toxic anymore. So looking forward on our developments, we are going to focus in the biotransformation strategy through enzymes and microorganisms.
Okay, so it's going to be hard times for mycotoxins soon.
Yes, exactly.
What is the general pattern in terms of mycotoxins? Are they becoming more prevalent or less prevalent in feeds?
What we can see is that the mycotoxins, they are going to become more and more prevalent.
Right.
Why? Basically, because the fungi fusarium that is very prevalent and develops the mycotoxin in the field, we see that when we have direct plantation of the grains, this fungi cannot be avoided into the fields. As well, with the climate change, these fungi, they are going to be developing more and more mycotoxins because we provide the conditions of temperature, and we see a lot about the moisture, the floatings that we are seeing worldwide. And when we have this combination, we can expect that we're going to have more development of mycotoxins.
Okay. And what about the change in aquaculture diets? That must have an impact on the prevalence of mycotoxins in the diets as well, because it's been a move away from marine ingredients to a higher concentration of grains.
Very well pointed. So when we have these changes on the fish meal and including more grains into the diet, what can we expect? We expect that we are going to have more mycotoxins because with the grains, the mycotoxins already come together.
Okay. So yeah, quite a concern. And so just to conclude, I suppose what advice would you give to feed formulators and feed millers about how they can combat mycotoxins and how they can ensure their feed is as contaminant free as possible?
Consider mycotoxins. When we are talking about a feed formulation, this is the art of the feed formulation. And if we want to have technology in the feed, if we want to go further in development, and we cannot expect something different if we are doing the same, we have to look for mycotoxins. These small compounds, if we do not monitor the contamination and we do not use a proper strategy for its counteraction, we cannot expect that we are going to avoid the risk of mycotoxins. And this is going to be always back in our mind. So to avoid the risk of mycotoxins, we really need a very well-done mycotoxin risk management.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you, Lorran.
Thank you very much.
Very kind. Thank you for your time. And very well put point. So thank you.
Thank you very much.